M is for math, the art of the number. Some get it naturally, some folks are dumber. Some math geeks were dicks, so let's take a look at two possibilities, Newton and Hooke. I'm Indy Neidell, and this is the World Dictionary, today featuring Isaac Newton and Robert Hooke. A lot of people who were geniuses, a lot of people who were genii, they had egos, right? Doesn't necessarily make them dicks, but still. Two genii from the 1600s were Newton and Hooke. Now, if you're wondering if these are actual portraits of them, the answer is yes and no. That is Newton, and that might be kind of what Hooke looked like. The last known portrait of him was destroyed 300 years ago, possibly by Isaac Newton. So this is the best idea we got. Newton was a genius, right? I mean, everybody knows that. But he seems to also have been a real dick. He believed, and I suppose he was probably right, that he was smarter than everybody else. But he seems like he might have been really insecure about it, since if anybody threatened his reputation as smartest guy in Europe and by definition the world, he'd kind of do whatever he could to defame or diminish them, like Gottfried Leibniz. Leibniz was also a genius, and here's the thing. You know how Newton came up with calculus? Yeah, well, so did Leibniz, at around the same time, independently. That sort of makes sense because René Descartes, who was also a genius and was not a dick as far as I know, had come up with analytical geometry earlier in the 1600s, and so had Pierre de Fermat, also independently, and I'm not going to talk about that, but the foundation was laid for the calculus, which is an okay name for a New York band from 2002. So who came up with it first? Well, the debate raged on for years until Leibniz, acting undickishly, said, let's let the Royal Society decide. By this time, though, Newton was president of the Royal Society, but he did the gentlemanly thing. No, of course he didn't. The review committee was made up of Isaac Newton's buddies, and Newton himself wrote the findings, and the totally unbiased committee ruled in Newton's favor. And that's what we say today, whether or not it's true. And a side note here, what is true is that it's Leibniz's version that we use more today, since that's the one with the dy, dx differentiation and integration notation, but you already knew that. Anyhow, Newton was totally a dick to astronomer John Flamsteed. Now, Newton needed data to try out his theory of the moon's motion, which in the first edition of his Principia, that was his masterwork, was incomplete. So he went to Flamsteed at the British Royal Observatory. Newton got Flamsteed to give him a bunch of his observations with a promise that Newton use them personally and not make them public. Newton also promised Flamsteed fame when the theory and observations were finally published. You can see where this is going, right? They had a falling out, and Newton had Edmund Halley, the guy Halley's comet is named after, publish the famous Mr. Isaac Newton's Theory of the Moon, which would have been a good name for a 60s Disney movie. As president of the Royal Society and thus in control of the Royal Observatory, Newton had Halley publish Flamsteed's star catalog. Yep, he just stole his years of work and gave credit to Halley, basically just to be a dick to Flamsteed. And then there was Robert Hooke. Here's a quote that must be accurate because I found it on the internet. Robert Hooke discovered the cell, established experimentation as crucial to scientific research, and did pioneering work in optics, gravitation, paleontology, architecture, and more. Yet history dismissed and forgot him, all because he pissed off Isaac Newton. Well, sorta, kinda. Actually, there's good descriptions of Hooke and his methods, well, and Newton, Leibniz, and more, in Neal Stephenson's Baroque Cycle, which is a brilliant trilogy by one of my all-time favorite writers that you should all check out. It seems likely that Hooke, too, was kind of a dick, but was out-dicked by Isaac Newton. Hooke was brilliant with mechanics and was a real all-rounder. For decades, he was curator of experiments for the Royal Society, from its beginning, basically. So he tested his own theories and those of others. Hooke's law is named after Hooke, and that deals with elasticity and stress on a spring, which led him to develop springs that made for reliable timepieces with things like a minute hand. He came up with the term the cell for the basic units that made up larger life forms, did astronomy stuff and worked with microscopes, had the theory that light was actually a wave, which would form part of 20th century particle physics and quantum theory, and his bestseller, Micrographia, surely made him well known to the public. But, other scientists kept claiming that they had his ideas before he did, and vice versa. Christian Huygens came up with the watch spring thing at around the same time as Hooke. So there was a big feud right there. And as for his feud with Isaac Newton, well, let's just say that in this case, history really was written by the winner. It began with gravity. Well, it always does, doesn't it? But in the years leading up to Newton's Principia, which came out in 1686, people were already hinting at the concept of gravity. So forget the apple hitting Newton on the head thing. Back in the 1670s, Hooke had said he thought the sun and the planets were attracted to each other, and the closer they got, the stronger that got. And he had the basic idea that it was a universal force. Newton came up with the whole theory, though. Thing is, Hooke thought Newton never could have come up with a theory without Hooke's input. Newton disagreed. Newton even said to Halley, remember him, that Hooke had written to Newton in 1680 about gravitation, but Newton not only took no insights from Hooke, but rather realized how little everyone else knew about the subject and how he, Newton, would have to figure out. It's possible, maybe even likely, that Newton's greatest quote, "If I have seen further, it is by standing on the shoulders of giants," was just a big screw you to Hooke, who is described as very short. You see? Huh? Not a giant. Well, we will never know for sure. What we do know for sure is that Hooke died the year Newton became president of the Royal Society. And that sealed Hooke's fate as the whipping boy of science. The one known portrait of him was lost or destroyed accidentally or on purpose, when the society moved. And there are rumors that Newton had it burned. And Hooke's reputation for centuries afterwards was that of a horrible, hideous man claiming credit for others' work. Thing is, he may have done that to a certain extent outside a fuse with Huygens and Newton. As curator of experiments, he borrowed ideas that were sent to him, and he did not give a whole lot of credit where credit was due. When his diary came to light in the 20th century, though, you got a picture of Hooke that was less of a monster and was a man who was pretty much his own worst enemy, partly by picking fights with other scientists, partly by being a weird and obsessive guy with no social skills, and partly by being too good at too much. Let me explain. Alan Chapman wrote a biography of Hooke a while ago, which is super expensive if you search for it on Amazon, by the way, called England's Leonardo. And he's got a really good theory for that. I mean, everyone's heard of Leonardo da Vinci, but why? I mean, sure, he was a total polymath, was good at anatomy, botany, engineering, you name it. But he wasn't known for that stuff during his lifetime. He mostly kept that to himself, which made sense since a lot of his ideas for things like helicopters were laughably ahead of their time. No, what he was known for was his paintings, right? They secured his place in history. And long after his death, then he gained recognition as a real genius and Renaissance man. But without the paintings, would we even know his name today? Chapman sees Hooke as Leonardo without the paintings. Sure, he was famous as a brilliant guy when he was alive, but now? You think of physics, Newton springs to mind. You think of relativity, Einstein. Boyle fathered modern chemistry, but Hooke? He did too many different things and never focused on one of them deep enough for a magnum opus. But this is the World Dictionary, and I have a job to do, so let's play our game.
Something a burglar would not want to see when he breaks into a house. Rob.
Naked grandma!
Naked, huh?
Okay, that's a better game, but I meant the scales. Okay, first, Isaac Newton and his achievements. On the positive side, look, it was Isaac Newton. You ever fly in a plane, or drive in a car, or use a cell phone, or basically do anything that involves physics or gravity? Thank Newton. That is a big 3 out of 3. However, even if Newton hadn't existed, you could still maybe thank Leibniz for a bunch of that, right? On the negative side, he had Flamsteed's work stolen. He didn't give him any credit. He was an egomaniac who demanded recognition for himself above all others, but he was Isaac Newton. He still gets a 3 out of 3. As for being a dick, he was a dick to Hooke, Flamsteed, Leibniz. However, he was never a genocidal or industrial scale dick. So I can't give him more than a 1 or 1.25 on the dick scale. So he ends up overall as a second class dick. Hooke? He didn't have a lot of achievements, sure, in a great many fields. He was also a credit grabber, even for things he did not deserve credit for. But just things like Hooke's law and microscopy max him out at 3 as well. To be honest, he doesn't seem like much of a dick, though. Okay, grabbing credit for others' ideas is a dick move, but there are a lot of things worse than that out there. Hooke ends up just at a 1 on the overall scale there, making him only a third-class dick. And hey, You had a lot of fun in calculus class, didn't you? Well, that is it for today and the letter M. If you know of any dicks throughout history that I should talk about, let me know why and who they are first and why in the comments. But remember, living people do not count. And if you want to go back to the beginning of the fabulous dictionary, you can start with it and check out the letter A right here. And to get more dictionary and more awesome stuff, you can join the TimeGhost Army at timeghost.tv or patreon.com. And you should click subscribe to never miss a single letter of the alphabet. And hey, don't be a dick.